teaching at Durham University. Let's give a warm welcome, please.
Mostly 80% nitrogen, right? Remember? 80% it is, right? 80%. Yeah. shatter. I probably shouldn't have said all that, but if you were to take a flower, let's say, and dip it in liquid nitrogen, then it would be so hard that you would be able to shatter it. I wish I had some liquid nitrogen here. I could show a nice demonstration. There's a nice demonstration where you can take a rubber band, which is very flexible, and you can dip it inside liquid nitrogen and take it out. You can snap it very, very easily. A rubber band that you would easily snap if it wasn't cold. So it's really, really cold. In fact, liquid nitrogen is so cold that if I had a bucket right now, so a bucket of liquid nitrogen, you poured it on the floor, it would just boil off, and you'll see this cool, like, steamy type of thing they have in nightclubs, but I'm guessing you're too young to go to nightclubs as well. So it's really, really cold, and liquid nitrogen is so cold that compared to the liquid nitrogen itself, the room acts like an oven. So it's the same effect that you would get if you were to take a bucket of water and pour it over a really hot stove. It would boil off. So the liquid nitrogen is very cold compared to room temperature. Just trying to help you appreciate how cold it is. But even at liquid nitrogen temperatures, our molecules and atoms are too slow for us to do what we want to do with them. The speeds are still very, very, very fast. Too fast for us. Okay, let's now look at the lowest naturally occurring things in outer space, temperatures in outer space. So the microwave background temperature is about 3 Kelvin. But again, even here you can get very, very fast, and at these temperatures, if you're now going to the fraction of Kelvin, you're still quite fast. And this is Hossein Bolt, he's called, right? So Hossein Bolt. He's really fast, and trying to catch him also would be really, really hard. I keep talking about catching things, and you'll understand a bit later on why we capture our atomic molecules. So they're still really, really fast. So we want to go even slower, even colder. Right, and how do we do this? Well, how low can we go? We can go very low, and I've already been how we do this. Right, before I really impress you with laser cooling, the technique, and how it works, first of all, I want to help you appreciate how slow we actually make these things, these atoms. So these atoms and molecules go from jumbo jet speeds, imagine, down to speeds at which snails or turtles or tortoises move. So that's really, really slow. Imagine jumbo jet down to which a snail moves, and we do this by using light, photons. How crazy is that? So, laser cooling, it is crazy, we actually do it, and it's crazy thinking about how you can look at laser pointer, how can you possibly cool something with light? Because on a warm day, you go outside and it's sunny and you feel the heat, and it's amazing. But yeah, we can make things very, very cool with lasers, and I'll tell you all about it. But before that, I want to help you appreciate why we do it. I mean, your daddies and mummies or guardians pay the taxes, and we use all the thousands of pounds to do our experiments of really fancy equipment. So I want to help you appreciate why we actually bother doing these experiments. Finding out that you're all A-level students, you're aware of the atom, you appreciate the atoms and the beauty of the atom, I guess. We all know about how it's mostly empty space. And how tiny it is. I've got a scale here just to help you appreciate, but I think you do appreciate it for the A-level students. My favorite thing about the atom, actually, is the craziness of the laws which govern the atom. So whenever you have fast-moving objects, really fast-moving objects, you have to move on from what we call classical laws to special relativity or general relativity, and with big objects. And whenever you go down to the other extreme, with very, very slow objects, you have to start looking into quantum mechanical laws. So the laws which govern how the planets move around the sun, there, but you can't say exactly where it is until you actually make your measurements. So I don't know how you visualize atoms in your head, but I always thought about it. This is how I visualize an atom, even at this stage. I still think of it like that, and which is wrong. So the electrons. Related to you being a in order to determine, in order to determine where you are, if you knew your distance from three different points, then you can tell where you are. So if you think of these satellites, each satellite as a person, and that person says, I'm at a certain distance from you, then you can draw a circle around it, where you could be, because you know where you are around the distance from you to this first person. Another person said, I am at such and such distance away from you, so then you can draw another circle. And then if the third person says it's there, then from the intersection of the points you can work out where you are. And the way that these satellites work out distance from you to from you, your receiver on your phone, to the satellites is it uses very, very accurate clocks called atomic clocks. So when we talk about the time differences with how fast things travel, they need to be able to measure time very, very accurately, very, very tiny fractions of a second. And this is enabled by using atomic clocks. So I won't tell you about how atomic clocks work. But atomic clocks use lasers called atoms. So when people came up with lasers, they never knew they could actually cool atoms down to very, very low temperatures, and then nobody else knew that we were going to then use cold atoms to make the most accurate clocks in the world, which would then be used to produce this global positioning system, first initiated by the American Navy.
When actually
computerized instrument, a computer, a phone, are what are called transistors, thing that revolutionized a lot of things. So these transistors keep reducing in size. Every year, each year, we can make them smaller and smaller. And by being able to make them smaller and smaller, you can therefore fit more and more on the same area, or you can reduce the area and still have more. So this is why you see computers reducing in size every year and becoming more powerful. But one day we're going to reach a limit. I mean, what's the smallest you can make something? It's the size of the atom. And then what do? The end of civilization? No! The answer is quantum computers. So what's different about a quantum computer? I won't go into too much details. In a classical computer, you have bits, like all the, what you see in the Matrix, all these zeros and ones flying around. So in a classical computer, you have the zeros and ones, which are the bits. And the sequence of these carries the information. In a quantum computer, say if you had a quantum computer, the bits would be quantum bits, and it could be anything like the state, let's say some sort of a state of the atom. So say a state of the atom with a spin, it could be pointing up, or it could be pointing down, and then it could be a superposition of the two. So with two possibilities here, you've got up and down, you've actually got three. And with two quantum bits, you get four possibilities. Quantum bits, you get eight. So the power in terms of how many possibilities you can have grows exponentially. It's 2^n. So with 300 bits, you can have a very, very, very powerful computer. Just to kind of help you appreciate this, in your phones right now, if you could count the number of transistors in your phone, which would take you a long time because it's about a few billion transistors in your phone, to provide the power you have on your phone. Very powerful, because they use much less powerful computers to go to do the moon landing in 1969, I think it was. So your phones are really powerful, they have billions of transistors. To get the same power for a quantum computer with quantum bits, you only need 300. So compare 300 to billions. Imagine what you could do with maybe a billion quantum bits. So quantum computers will be a lot more powerful, and they are the future, and since you're so young, hoping you will make it happen. So with today's computers, they're powerful, pretty powerful, but not powerful enough for us physicists to, say, simulate certain systems. So when we don't understand something, we try to go program something and try and predict it. But if we can't, if our computers are not powerful, we're not able to do this. In order to try and understand things, what we do is we try to form models and model in physics to understand things. And this is when quantum simulators come in. I won't go into too much detail about this. But to form a quantum simulator or quantum computer, you need to be able to cool things down to low enough temperatures that you can capture it. So in this simulator, the only thing I want you to gain from this is you've got this array, and the array is set in an array, and each point is like a trap, where the molecules are trapped. To trap something, like to catch the same bolt, it needs to go very, very slow. So to catch the molecules with the forces provided by the means you have, like lasers or magnetic fields, then they need to be slow. So you have to be able to cool atoms and molecules to do stuff with them. So I'll go straight into it. Oh, the shame they left. We don't know about lasers. You can tell them about it later. So I will now go on and tell you, give you the slice of cake, I guess. How do we cool things with the lasers? Sounds crazy. So I've got my photograph here. Laser shooting at the wing of something. I think it's out of play. Probably from Star Wars or something. So the heat is basically destroying it. So laser cooling is based on three different concepts, which I will discuss one at a time. We've got radiation pressure, resonance, and the Doppler effect. And these together produce the great friction force which slows the atoms down. Okay, how does this work? Let's start with radiation pressure. Actually, the answer to laser cooling has been staring at us for hundreds of years from radiation pressure is study examine the tail of a comet, what you would notice is that the tail always points away from the sun. It's not the same as when, say, a meteoroid lands on the Earth. I mean, well, actually, okay, the atmosphere pushes the tail upwards and the tail always points away. And with comets, the force which is pushing the tail away from the sun is radiation pressure. And the radiation pressure comes from the fact that photons, we all know photons are massless, they don't carry any mass, but they do have momentum. So it's this momentum of the photons, the many, many photons, which provides the radiation pressure and pushes the tail away. Okay, so that's one thing. We got radiation pressure, right? We've got two more things to learn about. Next one is, oh wait, now, okay, sorry. So first of all, I'll start off one at a time. So if you think of our atom, let's just deal with radiation pressure first. So if we just think of an atom as a football, I always like using different things than atom because some, when you talk to young people, they get scared about it, it's a big word. So if you think of a football moving along in that direction, then if I was to say, get one of you, a volunteer to come up and try and stop the football without touching it, and I only gave you some tennis ball, then you would say, okay, yeah, I can just throw the tennis ball at it in that direction, right? And then it would then slow it down. But if you threw a lot of tennis balls, then they would start moving to the left. Start moving to the left. So what you would say, okay, then I can just get someone else, another volunteer, to throw more tennis balls in the other direction. And this is what radiation, how we use radiation pressure in the laser cooling of atoms. So this atom tries to move in one direction, so we shine the laser at it. Your tennis balls are the photons here, and then there's the atom, and then more tennis balls. Another beam, laser beam in the other direction. So you might say, actually, you can move up and down and in and out of the board. So yeah, you do apply laser beams all the way. So you bombard the atom with photons which carry momentum from all directions. Okay, is it as simple as that? Well, you might think, okay, the atom is massive, and how much momentum does a photon actually carry? It's tiny. So you need lots and lots of photons. And to ensure that you get enough photons to be absorbed and then emitted in order to feel this momentum kick, is you need lots of photons. And for that, the requirements are a certain type of transition, which is we call it a closed cycle. So it's a type of transition where you can keep getting the same effect that you want. And for that, you need to be able to have the laser on resonance. So what is resonance, first of all? So things have what's called their natural frequency. I don't know if you've studied this, if you're with a pendulum and stuff. So you're familiar with this. Oh, yeah. So you have to push a swing at the natural rate. If I was to tap it at the natural frequency, you appreciate the amplitude would be greater. That's good. Well, if you understand that, then it's more or less equal. It's the same with atoms. So the frequency, the natural frequency of atoms depends on the energy level structure. So what we do is we focus on one transition. So here is the ground state and the excited state. Remember when you shine the laser, the atom then gets excited and then emits its photon. So we want to have the laser on this transition frequency. So the frequency where it's going to absorb, will be most likely to absorb this photon to feel the momentum kick, remember? atoms, what I do is I use radiation pressure, remember? So I apply laser beam in all directions, all 3D directions. So we've got three, the X, Y, and Z, basically. And then I make sure the frequency is basically lower than what is required, so that, such that only when the atoms move towards the lasers, they feel the kick. And voila, basically. Right, so now that we have our cool atoms, it's actually, there's a bit more involved in that. I need to optical track, but I don't have the time and stuff to go into that. That's like degree level. Evaporative cooling. So once you have your bunch of atoms, tiger trap. What you do next is you manipulate the trap in a way that you allow the cold atoms to escape. And this is what happens when a cup of tea cools down. So your hotter, more excited atoms or molecules in the water molecules in here escape, leaving behind the colder ones. So this is what they do. So here are atoms. Here are atoms inside the trap, which is what it's called, but it's hotter than this trap. So what you do is you make the trap shallower, just to kind of encourage the really excited atoms to escape. And when the excited atoms escape, you then end up with something which is colder. So this is called evaporative cooling. So laser cooling, followed by evaporative cooling, is the thing which led to the discovery of Bose-Einstein condensates, for example. So you can reach temperatures as low as 10 tens of nanokelvin in this department, Durham University. Right, I'm not working with laser-cooled atoms, actually. I don't do any of those experiments. I am working on molecules. So laser cooling of atoms has been around for many years, although not many people know about it, but they should. I work with molecules, and molecules are more interesting because they're more complicated. If you take even just two atoms and put them together, the energy level structure is much more different than the energy level structure of an atom. And this is the bit that makes it hard to laser cool them. Laser cooling has been achieved actually with molecules, but it's really hard and you're limited to only a few molecules because of the requirements of this closed optical transition. So, I decided to study molecules because I thought there's definitely a Nobel Prize coming soon. So let's get in there before I run out. Right, molecules are more complicated, so we can't laser cool them. How do we then cool them? How do we slow them down and cool them? Right, so my experiment works on basically this kind of principle. If we think about a molecule as a car going uphill, now, if it was then to roll back down, we would regain that kinetic energy. So, what we do in our experiment is we make these hills, but they're not physical hills. They're potential hills made by magnetic fields. So, we have our molecule which is coming along fast. We then switch on the magnetic field, and what the molecule sees is a hill. So, try to climb up the hill, and it gains this potential energy. Names are important, but it gains potential energy and therefore it loses kinetic energy, and you all know how kinetic energy relates to velocity, so it loses some speed. And what we do to make sure that it doesn't roll back down the hill, we switch it off. So immediately we switch it off at the point where it's at the top, and then we do another stage and another stage and another stage, as many stages required in order to extract however much kinetic energy we want from our molecules. So this process is called, actually, if you want to look it up and read the literature, it's called Zeeman decelerator. Okay, so I've got a nicer animation here just to show you how just like a turbo engine, so blades rotating very, very fast and getting the air in the chambers. So and there's another pump there, and you've got holding on the vacuum, which is very, very sealed very well. So this bit here is the source. So this is where we start off with our molecules or atoms. We make them there, and then we get them in a state where it acts like a magnet. So we want it to act like a magnet. And then the middle there is where we would have, if we were using the type of decelerator I just discussed, is where we have the solid as well. So we are still in the building stage from the experiment. And this is the bit where you detect it. So in order to know how fast something's traveling, you need to be able to measure the distance it travels over time. So what we know is we know where we make it, and then we detect it at the other end, and then we know the distance because we built it. So then we can determine the velocity and the spread of the velocities, and therefore the temperature. Because, you know, obviously you can't just dip a thermometer inside your cloud of atoms and molecules to measure the temperature. So we measure temperatures by looking at the distribution of velocities of atoms and molecules.
Was it an atom or a molecule?
I think it
temperature. So the molecule, with molecules, for example, it can rotate, it can vibrate, and then you've got translation. So with atoms, we talk about translational temperature. I'm not familiar with the nuclear stuff at all, but like, yeah, for example, the molecules, you could cool down the rotational temperature and not the others. You could transfer energy between the two. So it's possible to transfer energy from one system to another. But I'll look into that. So steam deceleration, the temperatures you end up with depend on your traps. Remember, it's a trap depth. Look, it's a thing that determines it. So we're limited to actually millikelvin. So it's hotter. Three orders of magnitude hotter than laser cooling. The plan is once we have decelerated the molecules in my experiment, we have them inside a trap. We can then use a different method, maybe evaporative cooling, to then lower the temperature. Or maybe we can even laser cool it if we're using special molecules. So yeah, millikelvin, it's hotter. How do I answer this one? So the photon momentum, as far as I understand it, it's crazy when you think about it, right? It's just the fact that it's a quantum, it's a quantized object. If you think of it as a wave or as a particle, then that's what helps me understand it. So even though the photons are waves, lighter waves, when it's in the form of a quantum, it carries a quantized energy, and the energy is the bit, the packet which provides momentum. That's as far as I can explain it. Any more questions? How does it work? My housemate makes them all the time. He does. How does it work? So how I can tell you, I guess, how is it formed? So from the De Broglie equation, you appreciate that as you lower the velocity, the wavelength part gets bigger. So what was Einstein? Condensate is a quantum state where all atoms exist as one object. And the reason is because, okay, so if you have, imagine you have a bunch of atoms, I don't know how many there, hundreds or thousands, however many. And if all these atoms they're quite close together because it's a cold packet. And because each one's wavelength is now getting bigger and bigger, so you get to a point, there's a certain kind of transition point, where they overlap. So all the waves, all the individual waves of the atoms become one big wave. And becomes one wave function, which then describes your packet. And it's a different phase of matter. And one of the things that my housemates does with these is they kind of try and push it around, because it acts as one object. They can do fancy things with it where they bash it against mirrors or things like that, surfaces. So it's a quantum object which is made of many, many small quantum entities. But it's kind of like all of us existing as one person, if you think of it like that. It really is like that, which is